It's another week in my fourth grade classroom where we are virtually learning and teaching and all that jazz. Come along and see how our week has gone. Hello, welcome. My name is Marily Sanchez, and I am a fourth grade teacher in South Florida. And I'm coming to you at the end of the day, Monday, November 16, 2020, to show you all the learning that happened in our classroom today. This morning, we started social studies, and we continued our Chapter 5 boat and bus tour of Florida. So we went ahead and watched this Fort Mose little guided tour so they can learn a little bit about the history there. And then we moved to Tallahassee, where we watched another slideshow presentation video from our tour guide as we learn about the mission in San Luis de Talimali. And then after that, we went over to a citrus grove in Central Florida in Polk County. And we ended our tour in Walt Disney World, learning about how tourism is an important part of Florida as well. We wrapped up the lesson by having some really great conversations about different topics that came up. And tomorrow, I hope to take the students into a Nearpod lesson where they can answer some of the questions that are in their social studies online textbook. But instead of having them go and putting their answers inside of this interactive electronic social studies textbook, I'm just gonna put them into Nearpod so we can have nice discussions there. So after that, the students had art, and after art, we met for our math lesson. Now, because they took a chapter test last week and I saw the data and the data lets me know that we need to go over the concept one more time, I took the seven questions that were the ones that were missed the most. Basically, it gives me an item analysis and I'm able to see what percentage of the students got the question correctly. So any questions that had less than 70% correct, then I went ahead and I went over with my students and I inserted them into a Nearpod lesson where we did different activities in order to review those skills and also kind of have the students give the questions another go. So this is the preview of the lesson that I created. So I'm just going to preview it so that you can see. This is a slide that I created within Nearpod. And then I put in some of the questions that they missed. So this one, they had to tell me which step the error occurred in first, and 27% of the class got it correct. So then I went ahead and I showed them the question, and this was a draw it so that they can use the tools and they can write over here if they want to. They can kind of see how to solve the problem. They can make this a little bit skinnier so it's not as thick, and they can try and work out the problems and see if they can come up with the correct answer. And as the students are doing that, I can see live what answers they are giving. So it was a really neat activity to start off. And then we moved on to the next question, which 33% of the class got correct. And this is our grid response. So I put the question here, I put the grid there, and then I took them to Jamboard. So I'm gonna click open the page, and I actually already deleted the first slide because I noticed that when I had the students go back to this Jamboard, because we use the same Jamboard for other problems that we're going to solve. These last two we're gonna solve tomorrow because we didn't finish. But the first slide I had to delete because they couldn't see the second frame, even though I moved there. So this is the second problem, but for that particular problem with the Nintendo Switch, I did the same thing where I wrote the problem at the top and we used the cube strategy in order to go ahead and solve it. If you want to get a free template of this Jamboard, it comes with 15 different frames that you can use. Basically, it's the same background, but in different styles. And you can just, in the one that I'm going to link down below, you can delete the ones that you don't want by clicking on the little hamburger there and deciding whether you want to duplicate or you want to delete. So I went ahead and used this to break down the problem. And then after that, we went back to Nearpod. So the cool thing is that in this preview, I opened it up, but in the students, it shows up within Nearpod and they can kind of see what I'm working on. And then we go back to Nearpod. And after that, we can then have the students answer it. So this is another draw it. The question is at the top and the students can then take their draw it tool and they can decide, you know, what the answer is. In this case, the answer was 385 and they fill in the grid
And they can try to write the number at the top as well. Writing with a mouse and being a left-handed and using my right hand with the mouse is kind of tricky, but that's pretty much what it was. And I can actually see how the students are responding and give feedback as well. So then we went on to the next question. 40% of the class got this correct. And then I went ahead and I took them back to another Jamboard, which again, for the students, it shows up within, but this is the Jamboard. It's loading the image, which is the same picture that you saw of the problem. But basically, I worked it out. I told them that with this kind of problem, they really needed to make sure they worked out each option. There it is, it loaded. And then figure out, you know, which one would not be it. So a lot of them chose this one, but they didn't pay attention that this is a times, not a plus. If it was a plus, yeah, it would have been a correct answer, but it wasn't. So we went over that, and let me go back. So as you can see, it kept going back and forth to Jamboard and doing different things. And then I gave the students the option to, you know, choose their answer and then keep going. And I got to, again, give them feedback. And then I think this is the last one that we went over. Number 14, 40% of the class got it correct. And again, we went to Jamboard. You already saw the one that I showed you. And then the students got to take the quiz again to choose the answer. So this is one that we are going to do tomorrow so that we can go over the skill. But I really like using this to go over the test and the skills because it allows me to give feedback to the students immediately and also catch any errors that they've been making. So this was a really good way to go and review that test. I did the same thing for reading. So after math, they had lunch, and after lunch, we had reading. And for reading, again, that test was kind of a little bit tricky because it was the first time that they were tested on informational text and the text structure of compare and contrast. And as you may know, text structure is a very complex standard. So we had to review the text and give feedback to the students. This one we did finish all the way through the end, and we only had to go over 6 questions that were the ones that I wanted to go over based on the data that I get from the test that they took. So this is another Nearpod that I created. And again, I had the students join, and then I gave them the text. So they could just click open and it downloads and they have the text and it's loading up right here. So if they're using the Nearpod app, the text shows up right on their app, which is really cool. But if they're using a web browser like me, I was just using Chrome, it does show up for them to open and download the document. But this is the first passage, All Shook Up, which is about earthquakes. So we read over that. And then after that, we started going over the questions. There were 2 questions that were missed in this one. So question 2 was 19% correct. And again, this is a compare and contrast. They had to pick 2 choices where the author uses contrast in this particular passage right here. So I had the students, again, take a little quiz and answer that question. And we were talking about magnitude, so how earthquakes are measured, and comparing the strength of earthquakes. Those were the 2 answers. And then the next one that they needed to go over, 50% of the class got correct, is a part A and a part B one. Again, talking about how the author shows how earthquakes happen and the evidence that supports that. Again, it's still text structure. So the author actually is comparing and contrasting what happens underground in different earthquakes. The evidence that supports that is right here, talking about how some happen in the middle of the plate and some happen along the fault. And then we went over to the next passage and we started going over the questions that were missed. So started with question 8, again, is compare and contrast. So you can see a trend here, which is great because I can reteach as we review the test. And here's the quiz. We're showing how they are different, how rain and snow are different. And the evidence that supports this is right here. People use umbrellas to keep dry from the rain, and they put on special clothing to keep warm in the snow. So then we go to the next question, which 63% of the class got correct. And again, is a contrast question where they had to choose 2. According to this paragraph, what is the author contrasting? And again, I gave them the quiz just to get feedback from them. And here they're comparing flooding inside and outside cities. And then they also are comparing the damages that floods create. So those were the 2. And the last question for this passage was for them to pick which of these statements were using compare and contrast. So it comes down to the signal words that let us know when compare and contrast is happening. So again, they took a quiz And in the quiz, they had to go ahead and answer that. So the water wheel looks like a wooden tire. Flooding in the cities is different from flooding outside the cities. People use umbrellas in the rain and heavy coats in the snow, and precipitation can be good and bad. And the last question is the short response, where they need to use both passages and describe how the author structured the passages to compare and contrast the effects. So they had the open-ended question, and it came up for them. And I had the question right here at the top, and the students could either type or they could record their answer if they didn't. And I also included the passages here, which for them, they could just, you know, download it and they can open it up. And this one has access to both passages, All Shook Up and The Importance of Precipitation. So that was a great way to review those skills and the concepts and take advantage and do a little reteach activity with that. So we ended the day with writing after reading. So I went back to my PowerPoint, and the same paragraph that they helped me write last week, I went ahead and color coded it within the PowerPoint. So I want to show you that. So here's the paragraph, and let me just go ahead and click play show. And as I keep going, you see my TREE strategy. We use the acronym TREE to help us build body paragraphs. It stands for transition, reason slash idea, evidence elaboration, or elaboration evidence. And we use as much evidence and elaboration as we need in order to fully explain our idea. So that is our transition, simply stated, followed by our reason one. And then we follow that up with elaboration, evidence, elaboration, evidence, another transition, evidence, and elaboration. So then I took the one that they worked on last week to fill in the blank in Nearpod. And if you want to see how I did that, you can check out my last video. But this one again, transition, reason two, elaboration, evidence, elaboration, evidence, elaboration. So after I show them this, I took them to Nearpod for another activity. And I've been loving Nearpod. A lot of the students were like, Miss Sanchez, we've been doing it all in Nearpod today. I'm like, yeah, I love it because one, it engages you. Two, I can see whether you are understanding or not, so I can address that and help you. So yeah, and also I went to Camp Engage this weekend for Nearpod, which is a online free event where a whole bunch of webinars were being held so that you can learn all the ins and outs of Nearpod vocabulary, how to use them to engage students, how to create lessons, and I'm hyped up, so I'm gonna be using Nearpod a lot. So this is the one for writing. And again, this is a slide that I created inside of Nearpod. So I started by giving them the passages, and I'm going to open it up. Basically, I've been showing this to you before, but these are our two sources for the rainforest informative essay that we're working on. So it's giving to the students, and at the end, they have the prompt as well, which we have already gone over. So let's get back to Nearpod. And after that, we went ahead and I reviewed again how we construct our body paragraphs, followed by our writing tree, which our topic that we're writing to is our trunk. The reason or ideas are the branches, and the leaves on those branches are the evidence and elaboration. So then we went into looking at that same paragraph that I showed. This is just a slideshow within Nearpod. The students can click on the pictures on the side so that they can see how it just keeps going, the different parts of that paragraph. And then we looked at the transitional phrases. And we had this collaborative activity where the students shared a transitional phrase that they can use for their body paragraph, their final body paragraph. And then after that, the final body paragraph is going to be about why should rainforest be preserved? So I had the students share all of these reasons why they believe rainforest should be preserved. It was an amazing strategy. I did take a screenshot of their answers, and let me see if I can find them because they were doing really good. I was really proud of the work that they were putting forward with this activity. And here is a screenshot of the last one, why should rainforest be preserved? And as you can see, Nearpod gives you the option to blur out their names so that you don't see who answered what. I did include this, which was our bucket for that we created based on why we need to preserve the rainforest. So they had that as a resource. And then they wrote all of these amazing different reasons why we should preserve rainforest. And they started playing around with the pictures, which they love doing that. So they would put their answer and then add a picture that was related to what we were talking about. All in all, it was a really engaging day full of learning, and I couldn't do it without all these amazing online tools that are available in Nearpod. I know this is not sponsored, but I just loved it so much, and I just wanted to share with you all the possibilities. And that is all that I have for today. And I know this has been lengthy for day one, so I will see you tomorrow.
Hello, everyone. It's not really Tuesday. We are actually now on Wednesday. So yesterday was such a go, go, go day that I wasn't able to stop and film what we did, but I'll let you know what we did, and hopefully it won't be as long as yesterday's, you know, short little Monday. Let's take a look at what we did. So let's go ahead and get started because I want to show you how we wrapped up our social studies lesson yesterday and then everything else that we've been doing with all the other subjects. All right, so we are going to start with Nearpod. I made this activity for the students to complete as soon as they came into my live Zoom meeting yesterday. So basically, they have a little reference here. This is one of the murals that the chapter talked about that is found in Little Havana. So they had this activity where they needed to create a mural about a hero in their life, and it could be a family member, a friend, or someone famous. Your mural should include these elements: the name of your hero and a bold, eye-catching illustration that shows your hero. So then they had the space here where they can use the Draw It tools. And then we did a little review of the chapter. And to do that, I had the students look at this map and look at all the different places that we were visiting on our Chapter 5 boat and bus tour. And I had them go into some VR experiences that I was able to put into our Nearpod. So Nearpod does have virtual field trips, and this is a virtual field trip of the Everglades, or one place in Everglades National Park. So with this, it's a 360 image, and they can literally just take their mouse and click and drag so that they can see the picture, they can see the different places. And one of the students is like, oh, there's an alligator in the water. It's right there. There it is. So it's a really neat experience that the students were able to do. They absolutely loved it. And then after that, they had to write one sentence in this open response activity that stated one thing that they learned about Everglades National Park. So we pretty much did that with every section. I also included a reference, so it is part of our chapter. So I have it so that the main ideas show in blue. And that's something that our social studies textbook allows us to do. So every place that we visited has that. So then the next place that we visited was Little Havana, and it didn't have a virtual field trip in Nearpod, but it's okay. I wasn't able to find one for every place that we visited on our tour. So I just make sure I included information from that section that the students can reference as they wrote their sentence about what they learned about Little Havana, Miami. Then they did have a virtual tour of the Kennedy Space Center. So this is one of the virtual field trips that I found in Nearpod, which is the entrance, so that they can take a look at it. And then again, they wrote one sentence of something they learned about Kennedy Space Center, also based on the text. And over here, they did one on St. Augustine, but for this one, it was kind of like out of order and I needed to fix that. So the virtual field trip came after the question. So I had them first go to the virtual field trip. So this is Castillo de San Marcos in St. Augustine, so that they can take a look at it and feel like they're right there. And then we went back to that open-ended question where they had to write one sentence about what they learned about St. Augustine, and they also had the text to refer to. And we did the same thing with the next place, which was Fort Mose. This one didn't have a virtual field trip, but they had the text for reference. And after that, we went to the San Luis Mission in Tallahassee. This one, there were a couple of different virtual tours, so I chose the one for the blacksmith shop. So we had very neat conversations. They wanted to know who these people were. I told them that this is now a tourist attraction that people can go to. And then they wrote a open-ended question, or they wrote a sentence basically about one thing they learned about that place. The next place was the Citrus Grove. I couldn't find any virtual tours of the Citrus Grove, but at least they did have the text to refer to, and they wrote a sentence about that. And our last place was Disney World. So they did a virtual tour of Cinderella's Castle and Disney World, and then they wrote a sentence about Walt Disney World and something they learned while we were on tour in Florida. So that was basically a wrap up. And then I had them do a draw it activity where they could circle the place that they liked visiting most. And then the next one, they just explained or gave, I think, one or two reasons. No, just one reason or why they chose that place.
And the last thing was a collaboration board where they collaborated and they wrote one word that sums up what they have learned about their tour of Florida. So that was the end of this social studies lesson, which then brought us into math. And in math, we basically just continued going over those questions that most of the students didn't get correct. So this is a word problem. It took us to Jamboard where we did our cubes at strategy. And then the students had an opportunity to redo the question. And then we went over the next one and they were able to redo that one as well in a quiz. And we did the next one, which was another word problem. So again, we went back to Jamboard. So this one shows that problem using cubes and the solution that we were working with together. And then after that, they had an opportunity to redo that question just so I can make sure that they understood it. And that was the end of our math review. That took us to the afternoon, which is our Reading Wonders unit. So I also did another Nearpod. And with this one, the students started by first looking at matching pairs, which is an interesting activity that Nearpod has. Basically, they're matching each word with this correct definition. So basically, enterprise is, let me see, something difficult or important that a person plans to do. And then we have exceptional, which is to be extraordinary, etc. So the students worked on that to review their vocabulary words yesterday. And then they watched a guided video on Main Idea, which is an interactive video that had various tasks. So here, what's your favorite ice cream flavor and why? The next one was, what is the relationship between the main idea and supporting details? And the last one, they had to find the main idea and topic of that passage. So after that, we went ahead and previewed the text by looking at the text features. So we were surveying the text. This is a slideshow within Nearpod. And then they had an opportunity to collaborate and let me know all the text features that they were able to notice. They had an open-ended question, which is an opportunity for them to write a prediction for the passage, and they could refer back to the cover in case they needed that. And we went ahead and we started reading the passage. So as we were reading, I did stop and I would ask the students different open-ended questions, and then we kept reading it today. So today we read about Anna Azevedo and Cecilia Cassini, and the students did the same thing. They had two open-ended questions where they needed to tell me what was their business and how it helped others. And then we read the last part of the passage and we had a quiz about the main idea of that last little section, kids count. And they can always click over here. I added this as a reference material so they can read back that section. And then after that, they took a quiz on the main idea of the entire passage. We ended with a collab board. What's one way you can help others in your community? So that was amazing. And after that, we went to GimKit. I created this GimKit for them to review vocabulary today because it was going to be part of their selection test. So basically, the students had questions that they needed to connect with the definition or the opposite or the same word, etc. And I just did the classic mode for GimKit, and the students played it for only 5 minutes, which was more than enough time for them to do the review. And then after that, the students went ahead and took their selection test. Yesterday after reading, we went ahead and started working on our informative essay third body paragraph. And I went ahead and I created this activity, this assignment in Microsoft Teams. So I gave them some reference materials. So here is the transitional phrases so they can look and see which ones they can use. And then I also gave them the actual text set with all the annotations so that they have the reference material so they can use it as they write their paragraph. And I also included the little bucket with all the different evidence that we had collected for the need for preservation. And then the students went ahead and did their assignment in a class notebook, which they just clicked on the link there. They don't necessarily have to go into their class notebook. This takes them there. And I included the body paragraphs 1 and 2, that the first one they helped me write together. The second one I wrote for their Nearpod activity. And in this space in the bottom, they get to write their paragraph by adding a text box so they can write it there. So I want to say I still feel like my students need more practice with writing. So for today's writing lesson, and I know I'm talking about both days, but they do really blend with each other. So today I focused my whole entire writing lesson on the TREE acronym that we use to build our paragraph. And I actually took them to Jamboard And this is what we created.
So it is a simple Jamboard. It does not have a background. I just use post-it notes that you get right here, right there. And tree is for transition, reason, evidence, elaboration. These are the same colors that I color code my paragraphs when I show them examples anyway. So I chose this transition. Let me draw your attention to the fact that, and this is the reason that that paragraph is going to be about, rainforests need to be preserved. Then we looked and found all the evidence that supports why they need to be preserved. And we elaborated on this evidence. Basically, how I did it is I asked them, okay, so this is the evidence. So what? Why is this important? How does it relate to the fact that rainforests need to be preserved? So then we added that. And for almost every piece of evidence, we did the same thing where we added all those pieces of elaboration. And then at the bottom, I started building the paragraph. And as I built it, the students were able to see the process. And some of them were immediately able to say, oh, wow, I need to go back to my paragraph and revise it and make sure I add more things that I need to add to make sure I explain my point better. So tomorrow, the students are going to continue working on that Microsoft Team assignment in the class notebook that I just showed you so that they finish that body paragraph. And on Friday, the plan is to do the conclusion, which is very quick and simple. That one we may just do in Padlet, if not within a Nearpod lesson. So we'll see. So that then takes me to what we did for science. Now for math today, we went back to chapter 4 and did how we interpret the remainder, and the students were able to actively engage in problem solving some problems so that they can then practice that concept on their own through Think Central and GoMath. I need to now take you back to what I mentioned, the selection test, which is an assignment that I created within Microsoft Teams. And the students basically did a forms quiz that I created based on those questions. And while they were on the Zoom meeting, they were able to complete it. So that was actually really great. And because we did all of that, I have to say, all my students did a pretty good job, the ones that have finished, on this selection test. And this is how the selection test looks. These are from Wonders. I just put it in a Microsoft form so that the students can answer. So as you can see, the first couple of questions are about the vocabulary words, and then the last five questions are about the passage, Kids in Business. So they completed that. It's only 13 questions. And I was able to give them immediate feedback as well as far as how they did on that assignment. So that takes us to our last lesson of today, which we have to continue tomorrow because I was only able to start it today. Because now we have Spanish, which starts our Wednesday. The students start for 1 hour in Spanish. So everything got pushed back and we lost a half an hour of science, but it's okay. We'll make it up. And we're going over the properties of matter. So this is the Nearpod that I did with the students. So we started here and I just put a lot of engaging activities within this and they loved it. So this is just a little snapshot from our science book. And then we went into a collaboration board where they needed to tell me what are some metal objects that they would like to find with a metal detector, since the previous page talked about those. And then we looked at the properties of matter. And then I had them do a draw activity where they needed to highlight the six properties of matters that the paragraph talks about. And after that, we went ahead and did an open-ended question where the students needed to choose one object in this picture. So let me click it so you can see it. So they needed to look at the picture and choose one object in this picture and describe it with two properties. So they did that, and then after that, we kept reading. We read about magnetism, and then they had a drawing activity where they had this picture, and they needed to draw an arrow where you see magnets sticking together. So that was fun. So we'll continue tomorrow with this visual literacy connection and wrap up our science lesson there. So that is all the learning that we have done in the past 2 days. I hope I was able to give you some ideas of how I'm structuring my lessons and the different tools that I'm using, but that is a mouthful. And again, I just talked a lot, sorry. I will probably see you tomorrow, if not Friday, but we'll see how it goes. Hello everyone, it is now Thursday. I'm coming to you at the end of the day, and I just wanted to quickly tell you all the learning that we did today. And it all started with Nearpod during our reading lesson this morning. So as you may already see a theme here and a trend, Nearpod is my go-to. So I'm showing you a preview of the lesson. It looks just like the one that I showed you yesterday. However, I used the same cover, but we actually were looking at the paired selection, which is starting a successful business. So I had the students take a look at this, and then I had them do a little activity on a collaboration board where they needed to share with me what do they notice on the cover and what do they think it will be about. And after that, we went ahead and continued reading the entire selection. After that, we went ahead and did a quiz, because before we went to the quiz, I made sure I reviewed main idea and key details and how to find them and what the whole passage was about, etc. So they first had to answer a question about what is the main idea, followed by another question, which was which key detail supports that main idea. So they were able to do that, and I love Nearpod because I'm able to see right there and then what the students are answering and how they're doing with that, and then I can share the results as well. Then we had a little fill in the blank activity where they needed to fill in the steps that it takes to start a business. They needed to drag the words from over here. So have an innovative idea. So I would take innovative and I would drag it up to that spot right there until I had the entire thing filled out. The students did that, and that was a great way for them to review what the text was talking about. Then our next activity was another collaboration board. I really love these, the students do too. Here they had to answer, how can an entrepreneur become successful using the information that they read in this passage along with the main selection, Kids in Business, which we finished yesterday. So after they did that, I had them do a draw it activity where, how about you? What business would you like to start as a kid? Draw a picture to represent that business, or find an image that represents your business. So the students had the whole canvas to themselves. They could use the tools down here in order to create their drawings, and they could even go into the internet and search for a picture using Google search. So that is how basically we ended our reading lesson this morning. So as you can see, high energy, very engaging, but that wasn't the only thing that we did during our reading lesson. I went ahead and I opened up a passage so that we can then apply all of those skills that we have been learning into our passage that we were going to look at. And I'm going to do a screenshot of what I ended up doing with that passage, because I showed it as a shared screen. I shared my screen PDF file, but then I used the Zoom annotation tools as I was being guided with them in order to break down the entire passage before they then had to go into Microsoft Teams and answer the questions that were related to this passage. So this is the passage. It is a helping hand, and it does come from our Wonders series. So Wonders, Unit 1, Week 5. This is in the practice book, and I was able to just have the students survey the text really quickly. We noticed the subtitles, the subheadings, and then we were able to also look at the graph that was being shown in the caption, and the students gave me a prediction about what they thought the passage was going to be about. Then we numbered our paragraphs, because one of the questions asked them to state three key details from paragraph 5 and then tell how all the details were connected. So we highlighted information that was important to the information that the passage was giving us. And this was the paragraph that they had questions on. So I went ahead and I highlighted each key detail in a different color so they could see it. And then the students were able to come up with the main idea of that paragraph. And of course, the main idea for the entire passage as well.
So lots of engagement, lots of activity for us to go ahead and fine tune into main idea and details. But that's not all, because another thing that we did as we were answering those questions and looking at the passage is that I took them to Jamboard while I had my screen shared, and we completed this new simple graphic organizer that I created. So here it is. This is a main idea organizer that starts with a topic. And we were looking at that paragraph 5, which is the question that they had to answer in their passage questions. So paragraph 5 dealt with donations. And then we took three details from that paragraph. These are just sticky notes. The background is an image that I created on PowerPoint, and I just included it here. So I just go to insert image and I search for it, and I had it in my Dropbox. So I just look for it in my Dropbox. I think it was under like main idea
I have so many files. So never mind all the files that you see here. It's a lot. There it is. So main idea. So I just inserted it and then I resized it so that it could fit the background of the Jamboard. And then the students gave me the details and we used the topic plus the details to come up with the main idea, which was donating food to a food bank can make a difference to people in need, so that they understood that. So
as you can see, that was a lot of learning during our reading session. And then the students were able to complete those questions on their own in their Microsoft Teams assignment, which I just included it in the class notebook and I just shared it with them so that they can go ahead and write the text boxes in the lines of the PDF document that I inputted it. If you're not sure how I did that or you have no idea what I'm talking about, you might want to check out last week's vlog because I kind of go step by step how I do it. But anywho, that was our reading and then it was time for writing. For writing, the students are working on that body paragraph that I told you. And I went ahead and I reviewed the same tree Jamboard that I showed you yesterday with them before they went in and they started working on their paragraphs. And can I just say, their writing is coming along. So I want to show you and showcase some of my students' paragraphs. So again, this is a notebook assignment. So basically, this is a PDF and I just inputted it into their notebooks. And here's one of my students' paragraphs so that you can see the tree. So here's the transition. There is still more to tell, and there is the reason. Rainforests also need to be preserved. So he started with the evidence and then elaborated that. And as you can see, if you keep reading it, there's evidence, elaboration, and they end with evidence. So let's take a look at another one. Now, I do want to say that these paragraphs are definitely a work in progress, but I am so happy to see the work that the students are doing and how their writing is improving as I give them feedback and give them suggestions. Here's another one. All right, and here is yet another one. As you can see, you can start to pinpoint all the different parts of tree, the transition, the reason, the evidence, the elaboration, as students are explaining why rainforests need to be preserved. Again, this is a work in progress, and it takes a lot of feedback from me and suggestions and modeling and scaffolding for them to get even to this point. And I want to say they were doing this assignment live on Zoom, and as they were doing it, I was clicking by student, by student, by student, seeing their writing, give them feedback, saying, hey, this works, but can you please also add this so it can bring it all together and make it complete? And it is starting to shape up. It is a lot of work, it takes time, but they're getting there. All right, and after that, we were doing math. We actually did two lessons in one because one lesson was super simple and did not need a whole class session to review. And then we went into dividing using the distributive property, which is great because it's like the opposite of what they learn in multiplication with the area model. So it was great. They are actually starting to understand division, which is amazing. So tomorrow they're gonna take the mid-chapter checkpoint and then we're gonna wrap up this chapter hopefully by Tuesday. So lots of learning. And then we ended the day with science. And of course, we took it to Nearpod, the same one that I showed you yesterday, but we continued it today. So we started with this visual literacy connection. And I went ahead and I quickly turned this into a dry activity. Nearpod allows you to do that. While you're presenting, you quickly can add an activity, and it is a temporary activity, but the students were able to circle the apple that they thought were the heaviest, and we were using all our five senses to describe the properties of each of these different objects. Then we read about hardness, which is another property, and the students were able to compare and contrast diamond and chalk. So the students were able to use this dry activity and create text boxes so that they can compare and contrast diamonds and chalk. Tell me how they're different and tell me how they are alike. The students did a great job as always. And again, it is an engaging activity and I can see if everyone is participating. And we ended this particular lesson with having them use the properties of matter to describe goldfish crackers, which was great because they were using all these different words to describe the color, the shape, the texture, etc. And the last question was like an exit ticket where they needed to go ahead and tell me how confident they felt in their ability to explain the properties of matter as they have learned in this lesson. And there is an image here that goes along with it. This did come from Nearpod, one of the Nearpod lessons. So this was great. And you would think we were done with science. No, my friends, we took it to GymKit. And the students were able to play on GymKit, answer 6 questions related to this lesson, which comes from our own science textbook. It is the lesson quiz. And the thing that I love about GymKit is I made it to be like a 7-minute quiz game. So they kept answering the same 6 questions over and over and over for those 7 minutes, trying to see how much money they can get, if they could be the person that got the most money. And of course, they use that money, which is fake money, to buy different power-ups that they could use for themselves or to pie another person's screen so they can't answer. Yeah, they wanted to play the regular power-ups, not the clean ones today, but they kept it fun and they had a blast completing it. And it was a great way to go ahead and assess how they understood the lesson. So that, in a nutshell, is our Thursday. And now we are going to leave right now and go to Friday. Hello, everyone. It is now Friday, November 20th, 2020. And I'm coming to you at the end of the day after another Minecraft Friday session with my students. And I just have to say, I'm starting to feel like my allergies are taking effect because I was just feeling like my throat was itching. Plus, I've been kind of stuffy. So I hope that it's just allergies, because nowadays, something like that is very concerning, especially for someone like me who's asthmatic and the current pandemic going on, right? But I wanted to quickly give you a rundown of the learning that we did today and how it went. And then I'm going to wrap up this video because it's the weekend and I'm going to enjoy it with my family. So we started our morning with a science lesson, and of course we were in Nearpod.
I found this particular Nearpod lesson that was already provided by Nearpod, and you can go ahead and do this with any of their lessons and edit them. But we did not finish it. However, we got to the FET simulation so that the students can manipulate the particles in the different states of matter. So we went ahead and went through the learning objective and the why we were doing this so that they can explain why this phenomenon will be happening. We went over the objective for the lesson. I also went ahead and I inserted clips from the actual science textbook that we use so that we can go over these concepts along with the Nearpod lesson that I modified. And then we also created this as a draw it so that the students can manipulate the visual and then continued learning about the properties of water before going into how we experience forces. They did a collaborative board on what different forms of water can you encounter in our everyday life. And after that, they did a poll where they had to answer, does water always look the same? And then this really cool experience, get ready to experience water. So we went on a virtual field trip with a VR experience at Yellowstone National Park. So this is a hot spring at Yellowstone National Park. So the students had the opportunity to discuss what they were observing as it related to water. So they were able to tell me that there was water vapor above the liquid water, and there was also solid forms of water in the snow right there in the background and also in the path over here. So this was a really cool experience. They loved it. And then we went ahead and did a think, pair, share. And we did this Let's Explore, where we start to go ahead and start working on the virtual lab, which is by FET. So this is a slide that just explains what they're going to be doing. And then it was time to actually do the virtual simulator. So just give it a moment because it's loading, but check it out. So this is neon, the gas, and they can manipulate the atoms and molecules of 4 different substances. So let me go back. So that's neon, that's argon, that's oxygen, and that's water. And they can see it in different states. So this is solid, liquid, and gas. And they can also see how each of these looks in the different states. And they can also manipulate here to cool it down to see what happens to the particles and to also increase the heat. So they can see what happens to the particles. And the thermometer is right here, and we can switch it to Celsius so that they can see the temperature. But it was really neat. So that's pretty much where we ended. And they did this collaborative board, what happened to the molecules as you switch between solid, liquid, and gas. And next week, we'll continue with the rest of the lesson.
The students really loved it. They didn't want to finish the science lesson, and I love that I can bring science to life in a virtual setting using a tool like Nearpod. So then it was time for math. The students took their mid-chapter checkpoint, and then we continued on. We were learning today about using the subtraction, repeated subtraction strategy, and partial quotients when we are dividing. To do that, I quickly just went to Jamboard, and I created a simple little Jamboard where I literally was drawing with my mouse, but showing them the steps for 91 divided by 7. They could do it with repeated subtraction, as the video said, subtracting 7 over and over and over. Or we could just use multiples of 7 to subtract it and then add the partial quotients, which is related to what we did the other day this week, where we were using the area model and the distributive property to do the same. And we still get the same answer. So that's what we ended up doing for math. And for reading, I wanted to go ahead and make sure the students reviewed suffixes before they took their reading test. So I went back to Nearpod. I found the suffixes lesson or activity in Nearpod, and then I just modified it a little bit. So it goes over what the activity is, and then it brings a poll asking students if they know what a suffix is. And then we went ahead and did a little matching pairs activity where they needed to match the suffix to the meaning of the suffix. So they did that for all of the different suffixes that were around until they matched all of them so that they can see what the suffix meant. All right. And after they did that, we completed this table where they needed to connect the root word and the suffix together to make a new word and tell me what that word meant. So they did that with all of these. And then we read this passage right here with these sentences. And then they answered these questions related to that passage. And then this is from our Wonders. It's a draw it activity where they had to underline the suffix and then tell me what the word meant on the line. So they worked on that. And then they did a poll as an exit ticket to show me how they felt about their knowledge of using suffixes, and that was the end of that lesson. So after that, they took their reading test and they're pretty much done with that. I only have one more student that needs to finish that. And then we went ahead and started our writing class or our writing lesson. For our writing lesson, we went to Padlet since we were writing the conclusion to our rainforest essay. We're trying to wrap it up today. And I gave them an example along with the different ways they can start their conclusion. And I added those images to the Padlet and they started writing their conclusions to this essay. So here is our Padlet. As you can see right here, if I were to click on this picture, it shows up bigger. This is the example that I gave them on how we can finish up our rainforest essay. And then I also gave them this picture so they can see the different ways that they can start their conclusion paragraph. And then my students wrote their conclusions, which we are not done. I have to still go back and give them some feedback so they can go ahead and correct it. But overall, I'm thinking that they're doing a great job concluding and wrapping up the topic of why rainforests are important and why they need to be preserved. So that is all that we have been doing today. And now you have seen everything we did this week. It was a full 5-day school week, but it's interesting because one of my students said, "Miss Sanchez, this week actually felt like it went by really fast." I'm like, "I know, right?" And last week we only had 3 days and it felt like it was dragging. But this week I feel like it did speed up and go pretty fast. All right, so I hope you enjoyed coming along with us. If you did, don't forget to hit the like button. Leave a comment down below. Let me know what you thought or any questions you may have. Also, if you haven't subscribed, please consider subscribing and hitting that bell for notifications so you don't miss any future videos. I hope you have a beautiful, magical day, and don't forget to smile. Hello, dreamers, wishers, and magical thinkers. Thank you so much for making it to the very end of this video and for showing your support. If you'd like to subscribe, you can do so by clicking on my picture down here. You can also check out my latest videos here and here. Don't forget to believe in the magic that's inside you because you are capable of great things. See you next time.